Hello everyone, welcome back. So now we'll start with the next experiment, that is atomic absorption spectroscopy. This is also called AAS, atomic absorption spectroscopy. The principle of this experiment is when a solution which is having a mixture of metallic spaces is introduced into the flame, the solvent evaporates and vapor of metallic spaces obtained. Some of the metal atoms can be raised to an higher energy level, sufficiently high to emit characteristic radiation of metal. This phenomena which is used in a flame photometry. So here again same experiment as flame photometry. Here this is the simplified diagram of AAS equipment. Here you can observe a lamp, a sample is kept here, and this is the flame containing the sample, and this is monochromator, and this is photo multiplier, and this is a detector, or you can read the readings over there. So here this is the diagram of AAS equipment. So apparatus consisting of radiant source, atomizer, monochromator, lens and slits, and last one is detectors. So this is about the apparatus. So next we'll study the procedure of this experiment. So first in this experiment, first spectrometer is adjusted to read zero absorbance or 100% transmittance. So 100% transmittance and zero absorbance are one and the same. So next, when a blank solution is sprayed into the flame and light of a hollow cathode lamp passes onto a photomultiplier tube. First, you're supposed to spray the blank solution into that flame, and which passes through hollow cathode lamp. Next, solution which is to be taken, that is which is to be tested, that is introduced, and a certain part of light is absorbed. As its principle says, some of light is absorbed here, and that results in decreasing of light intensity which falls on photomultiplier. So next, this gives a deflection in the meter needle, which is noted immediately. So the last, whichever the detector we can say, or reader, that gives the deflection, which can be noted very soon, as this this is a comparative method. So hence this standard solutions of elements are used to make a calibration curve from which the concentration of sample elements can be calculated. So this is about the procedure of this experiment. So now we'll study the instrumentation of this spectrometer. Radiant source. So this these are the some components which are used in the instrument. First is radiant source. This radiant source generally used is a hydrogen lamp, is used as a continuous source of radiation. The second one is atomizer. So atomizer are generally burners which are used to break the liquid sample into droplets, and again which are then allowed to enter into flame. So this atomizer, as it atomizes, that means it breaks the liquid, and that can be allowed to enter in the flame. And this in this process, the sample is reduced to atoms. If it is molecule, it reduced to atoms. So third one is hollow cathode lamp. So these gases emit sharp line spectra. So generally these lamps are constructed for individual elements, but multi-element lamps have also been prepared for all the purposes. So the hydrogen lamp is a hollow cathode lamp in this experiment. So this lamp emits more than one composite line for each element, but the required spectral line can be separated by means of relatively low monochromator. So this is about the hollow cathode lamp. So next is monochromatic So this monochromator is nothing but this. Generally, the monochromators are gratings and prisms are used as a monochromators. The fourth one is filters or slits. The filters or slits are used for isolation of required spectral lines. Here, these filter photometers are used for determination of it may be sodium, calcium, potassium, magnesium, in other metals also. Last one is detector. As it detects, detectors are nothing but photo multipliers. In some instruments, two filters and two detectors are used for a fluctuation in the source. So this is about the main components which are used in the instrument. So next, we are going to study the nature of graph. So for nature of graph, here along the y-axis we are plotting absorption of the particular solution, and here the copper concentration is plotted along the x-axis. So first starting, it gives straight line and then the curve starts. So that curve is called calibration curve. So by this graph also we can calculate or we can determine the amount of copper or amount of any metallic compound which are present in a unknown solution. So this is about the nature of graph. So next we'll study some of the applications of this AAS, that is we can use this experiment for a quantitative analysis of this elements. And next we can also have some disadvantages of this AAS method, that is this technique has not proved very successful for the estimation of elements like vanadium, silicon, titanium and aluminium also, because these elements give oxides in the flame. So some of the elements they react with the flame, and in presence of that flame gases they will oxidize. So this method is not successful for some of the elements. The second one is, in aqueous solution the anion affects the signal to a noticeable degree. So in aqueous solution also it fails. Third one is, a separate lamp is needed for the determination of each element. So attempts are being made to overcome this difficult by using a continuous source. So this is also some kind of difficulty we are facing in this atomic absorption spectroscopy. So this is the advantage and applications of AAS method. So this is all about the atomic absorption spectroscopy experiment. So now we'll move to the next experiment, that is fourth, potentiometry. So as in lab also you have this experiment, potentiometric estimation of FAS. So same will be given in theoretical part also. So here principle of this potentiometry method titration is, this is a redox reaction, as here both oxidation and reduction are taking place. So this redox titrations can be carried out potentiometrically using platinum calomel electrode with a combination in manner which is similar to, this is similar to acid base neutralization. So here first this reaction is like a reduced form that gives rise to oxidized form plus n number of electrons. So you know that anode reactions and cathode reactions, so as both oxidation and reduction is taking place in this reaction, so this reaction is called as a redox reaction. So as you know, the potential potential is given by Nernst equation. You know the formula, that E equal to E naught plus 0.0591 divided by n log of oxidized form divided by reduced form. So here we are going to oxidize this Fe plus 3 ions, that is oxidized form of this Fe in FAS, that is Fe plus 3, and reduced form will be Fe plus 2. So this is the Nernst equation for this particular reaction. So here E naught is nothing but standard electrode potential of the system. So So now we'll study how the procedure is done. So first you need to take 25 ml of FAS with the help of a pipette into the beaker. So you just pipette out 25 ml of FAS into beaker and then add one full test tube of dilute H2SO4 and then fill the burette with the K2Cr27. As you know, K2Cr27, which is a strong oxidizing agent, that is in presence of an acidic medium. So just to maintain an acidic medium, you are using this H2SO4 in the beaker. So next, you just immerse the platinum calomel electrode. Here platinum electrode and calomel electrode will be taken. One is indicator electrode, which indicates the change in the concentration, and calomel electrode, that is acting as a reference electrode in this case, which is immersed into the beaker, and connect the electrodes to the potentiometer. The next, note down the EMF of the cell before addition of K2Cr27. So without adding any drop of K2Cr27, take the first EMF reading, and then after this you need to add 0.5 ml of K2Cr27 from semi micro burette and allow that to the solution to mix well and measure the potential. So like this you need to continue the procedure till a sudden rise in the EMF of the cell is observed. Here as you are going to add K2Cr27 0.5 ml each time, so Fe plus 2 is undergoing Fe plus 3, and that chromium which is present in the K2Cr27, that is undergoing reduction, that is from plus 6 to plus 3. So both oxidation and reduction process are taking place simultaneously. So here with this change in the EMF occurs, so we can observe the change in the EMF and repeat this for 10 ml. So this is about the procedure. So next we'll study the instrumentation is it's very simple. So one potentiometer is taken, which is consisting of indicator electrode, that is platinum electrode, and one more reference electrode, that we can say calomel electrode, and potentiometer. This is about the instrument. And graph here we can plot this graph with the help of delta E is change in the, here you see delta E is change in the EMF and the ratio divided by delta V, that is change in the volume each time we are adding 0.5 ml. So ratio of this is plotted against y-axis, and the volume of K2Cr27 that is we have added each time 0.5 ml, so that is noted in the x-axis. So this these two gives you a graph like this, and this peak point gives you the equivalence point, which indicates the amount of volume of K2Cr27 which is required for the conversion of Fe plus 2 to Fe plus 3. So this is a very simple instrumentation burette. We have taken K2Cr27 here, and these are two electrodes. One will be platinum electrode, that is indicator electrode, and another reference electrode we have taken, that is calomel electrode, which are connected to a potentiometer which gives change in the EMF. So this is about the instrumentation and graph. So application are by this experiment we can study the colored solution, and even we can study the redox titrations and even acid based titrations also, and precipitation reactions also be carried out this potentiometric method. So this is all about the potentiometric titration. Thank you.